If you're a woman, you have only two ways, feminism or masochism. Stay tuned and let's talk about two great women who definitely chose the first path and who became pioneers in Ukrainian female literature. Hello and welcome to our 5 Minutes with Ekaterina Ukrainian Literature. Today we are talking about two great women without whom we would never know about Lesa Ukrainka, we would never know about the poetess who now stays on the same stage, on the same level as great poet Taras Shevchenko, who lived before her, who lived one century before her. I'm talking about Natalia Kobrinska and Olga Kosach. They were women from very different backgrounds and they lived in different parts of Ukraine. Natalia Kobrinska was living in the Western Ukraine, which belonged at the time to Austro-Hungarian Empire, and Olga Kosach lived in the so-called left bank part or over Dnieper, high Dnieper part of Ukraine, which at the time was belonging to the Russian Empire. And they spoke Ukrainian, they both spoke Ukrainian, they both considered themselves as Ukrainians, and they were very high educated women who wanted to contribute into society, who wanted to get proper education, and who loved to create some pieces of literature to contribute to spread these ideas to the broader society. As for Natalia Kobrinska, she was born in the priest's family of Ozarkevich family. They have a lot of famous people. They had not only priests, they were authors of books too. They were different, they were wealthy, good educated, intelligent family of the time. And she was born in the times when women cannot get the education, so she was self-studied. All her brothers were studying in Vienna, which at the time was the capital of Austro-Hungarian Empire, but she as a female didn't have this ability. So what she did because of that, she had to read a lot of books, she had to be self-studied, and it's very common that when you want to educate yourself, you're educating yourself even better and you have better education than anyone who is attending the structured classes within some kind of university environment. So that's exactly what happened to Natalia, and also she started to read some kind of advices for educated women, and there was a man saying that if you want to be educated, you should educate yourself in fashion and in household. And then almost at the same time, she read the book of a Polish feminist who said that women actually are equal to men, who described the situation in Poland when women were oppressed. And despite in Natalia's family, her mother was the leader of the family, which is pretty common for Ukrainians, and they had a very good relationships with her father. She started to think about it, and she started to think about equality, and she started to think about why women are not at the level, at the same level with men. This thinking and the way of education she got brought her to the conclusion that she has to explain other women that they need education, that they need to educate themselves, that they need to bring their level up, and that they need to somehow to improve themselves, to show that they can contribute the same to the society, and to get this right of equality. Let's read the part which she wrote herself, and that's her ideas, and I cannot describe them better actually. Не раз уже говорено, що теперішнє положення жінки в суспільності кидає в многих взглядах не дуже корисне світло на стан і висоту нашої культури. Бог знає, що не видумувано, аби повстримати виробляючеся переконання, що положення це може бути змінене і безмилосердно нівечено в опінії прилюдній самостійно виступаючих жінок. Довго войовано фразами, які лише в давній хвилі нахоплювалися на язик, не входячи в глибину річі. Декотрим надавано навіть поважно науковий вид. Говорено і писано, що жінка не спосібна до тих занять, які мають мужчини, вже для самої фізично слабої будови тіла, а також задля недостатньої ширини духовного розвою. So this last sentence, because of the lack of spiritual education, female cannot be equal to man. It was something she thought about really hard, and she wanted to change it really badly. And what she did, she wrote approximately 400 letters to different women and invited them to publish their own poems and to publish their own pieces of literature under one cover, and to create this kind of literature society for females only, to show that females are equal and can do it the same way as men. Not only men, but also women, they said, no, why should we? We don't want to. And the order of things is normal. She was such a pioneer at the time. And she was very persistent in her goal. And she found 17 women who helped, who decided, who said, yes, we are going to publish something under this book cover. One of these women was Olga Kosach. And I'm saying Olga Kosach, or maybe you know her under the name Olena Pchilka. And when we study her in school, we study only small short poems for children written by her, and the only thing they tell us is that she was the mother of Lesa Ukrainka, and that's it. Of course, she was the mother of Lesa Ukrainka, that's true, but besides that, she was one of the greatest mecenas, greatest contributors, supporters of poetry, supporters of art. She gave so much money to publish the different pieces of literature. She published different magazines, and most of the time it was male magazines which she was publishing. And this call of Natalia Kabrinska, this ask, this letter, she decided to support this idea, and they together put their money together and really published the book with female only poetry. And there were only 17 women at the time who wanted to do it. Like, can you imagine, out of 400, only 17 people said, yeah, we should do something like this. That's how bad the situation was. And this first poetry collection, it was published in 1887. It was called Perszy Winok. And now we look at that not from the point of view of a great literature work. The young Lesa Ukrainka was also contributed a poem to this magazine, but we look at it as the first statement that women can do actually something. Let's read together the poem written by Olena Pchilka and starting this book. Перший вінок. На працю нашу уважати не вам славутні митці. Ваш суд не має осягати спробунки нашої отці. Для душ несміливих, лагідних ми теє слово подаєм, і в їх у сестер наших рідних покличем слово навзаєм. За досить довго нишком тліла та іскра Божого огню. Нехай спалахне, щоб горіла, нехай оглянуться на ню. Одна фіялочка схована, єсть незамітна у гаю. Лиш з гуртом сестер поєднана, знайму я дух цноту свою. До спілки ж, сестри, в нашім гаю вінки ми праці пов'ємо. І на користь рідному краю жіноче серце віддамо. These words, I cannot describe better what they were doing, and I cannot describe better how not certain they were about it, because you can read it in this poem, you can read that it's modest, and we don't judge us through the literature, from the literature point of view. So they were not very confident on what they are doing, but they did a great job, because they showed an example, and they were a role model to so many women after them. And slowly, step by step, especially after in the 20th century, it was again, it was the 19th century, it was the period when women didn't have any kind of rights. They didn't have the right to vote, they didn't have the right to study, they didn't have the right to express themselves, to dress how they want. So it was the time, and even females, they think that it's normal. And also, when you read the first published piece of literature written by Natalia Kobrinska, it's a short novel or long story, if you want. So she is describing the situation. She's explaining that women themselves, they didn't think that they deserve it, and they didn't think that they should be equal. And these two women, they showed that they can, they should pursue it, and they started to be the models to the next generation. One of the reasons why we don't study these women at school, for example, or probably you haven't heard about them, they're not so famous, is that they were writing 1 century ago, and it's not very easy to read them. Even when we were reading Olga Kobylenska together, it's quite hard to read it because some words we don't use anymore in modern Ukrainian language. We don't use this kind of grammar anymore. And when I'm reading it, even when I was reading this poem, I noticed that sometimes stresses they stand just in the different places of what did I used to do or like nowadays. And for now, again, it's very important to look at them as to the developers, to the contributors, to the pioneers, and maybe don't judge their literature. But as for me, the literature is also very important. They gave a very important thought that later would be developed, and nowadays it will come to the situation when anyone can create YouTube videos and get a proper education. Again, as always, it's not enough time to cover everything because, for example, Olga Kosach, she was the delegate to the St. Petersburg, to the capital, to protect Ukrainian literature within the Russian Empire, which the mission was failed because the Russian Empire didn't want any kind of Ukrainian language. But again, it's so important. And also, it's important to tell that Natalia Kobrinska, she was very active as a civil activist, and she had the first union of Slavic women in the Western part of Ukraine, and again, it's a very important thing which you cannot cover in a very short video. Thank you very much for watching. I'm waiting for your comments as usual. Tell me, what is your idea? Would you become a feminist even now? Do we need a feminism now as a movement, and how it should be represented? Again, don't forget about your likes. If you can, support me on Patreon, because that's how I can improve the channel, and that's motivate me a lot to create more of this. If you can't, please just subscribe, press the bell, and follow our new episodes. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to meet you very soon. Goodbye for now.